Now, my name is Juan, and I work as a dating dinner at Lovu, which is a dating and social application based here in Germany. And for today, I have a very nice presentation and one that I've been wanting to do for a long time. And I'm calling it Two Clicks to Cluster and Block Thousands of Spammer. So let's begin with a bit of a story time. And this is actually my second time working here at Lovu. Previously, I used to work here from 2016 up to 2019. However, at that point, I got the travel bug and I got like the itch to replace the keyboard for my backpack, the IDE for a camera, and the trip to the coffee machine for straight to the beach. So I left the company and went backpacking. And this is the route I spent for the 416 days, mostly in New Zealand and Southeast Asia. However, something very unexpected happened, and that was COVID. So COVID came, and I was in New Zealand all alone during lockdown, and I had no idea what to do besides making funny pictures of myself. And one of those days, I had one thought, and I was like, I miss my old job and my old colleagues, of course. I wish I would have done that cluster thing that I wanted to do. If life would give me a second chance, I'll do it. And since we're tech people, it kind of looked like this. I have my switch, all my cases. The first case already happened, this in the past. The second case was let's do cluster. And the default case was like, I have no idea what I want to do. So as you can guess, I'm here today, meaning that I got my second chance. And of course, now I want to present my clusters. So once again, I'm Juan, hello there. And I work as a dating dinner at Lovu. And there I work with fraud and spam. And my task is to develop and to design the system that we use to moderate the fraudulent and spam content. For doing so, we use a combination of data, algorithms, machine learning, and common sense, which is very important. Also, I'm a person who likes clusters, as you will see in a few minutes, and I'm a former backpacker, photographer, and writer. And during my time backpacking, I wrote a book. It's called Practical Tensorflow JS, and I wrote it while I was backpacking, so that was actually quite cool. So now, for today, this is the agenda. I'm going to start with the context of my problem. Why am I doing this? Then I'm going to talk about the clusters, the architecture of my system, the feature vectors, the clustering algorithm, outcome, takeaways, and unfortunately, I need to come to an end. So let's start with the context. Why am I doing this? So Lovu is a social and dating platform with two main functions or two main applications. One of them is dating. And in dating, you are scrolling through many profiles, you go to left and right, trying to meet your significant other or trying to have like some nice adventure. On the other hand, you have the live streaming. And during the live streaming mode, you are like this with your phone and you stream to other people. And people, they buy you presents. People use their money to buy gifts and they send you those gifts. The main problem here is that these two facets of the company, they attract spammers, mostly on the dating side, meaning people that spam other platforms or people that send you unsolicited content or just bots. And on the live streaming, since there's money, since we have an economy, of course, every single time you have something online that involves money, people are going to try to make the most out of it in a very negative way. So even though these are different targets, at the end of the day, they are unwanted content that we want to remove. And these are some of the techniques that we use. We use machine learning. Most of the time, we're talking about anomaly detectors just to detect fraud. And also we use information retrieval algorithm, time series, heuristic, rule-based system, and one of the most important, conviction. So conviction is our score collector. It is the component that gathers all the score from all the other systems. And these scores, we call them confidences. And we group them by system. For example, we have all the fraud-related scores here and all the image-related confidence score here. And from this huge collection of scores, we manually create rules. For example, if confidence 1 and confidence 2 is greater than some threshold n, then we block the user. But there's one small slight problem that we have over 200 score. I believe today we have 274 and that number is not getting smaller and smaller. So we need to try something else. We need some extra help to how to get all these scores and doing rules out of them. So because of course, they keep getting harder to model them by hand. And that's why we have the cluster. So this is an image of one of my clusters. And what we have here is like a two-dimensional representation of one of my many clusters. And for this, I'm using a dimensionality reduction algorithm. However, this is not the clustering that I'm going to, that I just cluster. The cluster is color based on colors. But even with that, we can see that there's some kind of separation. We have like the green are here, the red are here, the purples are there, the blue are there. So even by just projecting my data into a lower representation, we can see that there's something going on. There's a clear separation that is also boosted, or that is also approved by the clustering algorithm itself. And this happened because clusters and unsupervised learning in general, they excel at discovering patterns from unlabeled data. And trust me, we have way too much unlabeled data, which is also one of our problems. And our intention, once again, is to grab a collection of users, what we call a batch of users, and their confidence scores, and do the following. The first one is to group, is to cluster these users and plot them, of course. And what I do here is that depending on the percentage of already existing spammers that I have within one cluster, then I decide if I want to block the remaining percentage. For example, let's suppose that I have a lot of users, I do a clustering algorithm, and cluster number 4 has 99% of spammers. So I'm like, if 99% of the people here are spammers, then I'm just gonna click the button and block the remaining 1%, because the chances are that that 1% is also going to be spammer. The second thing that we want to do is to create new rules for our rule-based system. And for this, we want to take a more supervised learning approach where we learn some rules from some labels, and then we move all these rules into our conviction system. I'm gonna talk about this later. And last, I want to visualize them to see separation in the data, like I showed in the previous image, and also because it's always quite pretty to see images, or I can apply them. Now, the architecture, how is this actually happening? So this is our first screen. This is what I call the anti-spam web interface. And here we do all funny things, like we click user, we see information, we block user, we do everything from here. And we have this, and this is our batch screen. And on the batch screen, we have all of our users, a lot of things that, of course, I need to hide because I don't want the spammer to see the information. But if you look on the top right corner, there's one button called cluster batch. And that's the first button, the first thing that I want to, that I have to click to to punish my users. So how do I go from that to here? Well, like this. So we have our conviction system, like I mentioned. It is one processor, what we call a Kafka processor, that is getting data from all our other components. The thing is that we don't have just one component. We have many of them. And they share what we call a conviction score stream, which is like a Kafka stream where we input, where we send a bunch of confidence score, and then conviction is going to receive this score and is going to store them in something that we call a Kafka state. And a state, let's say it's some kind of key value database where the key is the user ID and the value is a map of all the confidence score that a user has. So every single time we receive a new score, we replace the old value that we have for this key for the newest one. Then we also have the anti-spam web UI, which I just showed. And however, there's no direct connection. There's no like a direct layer between the anti-spam web UI and conviction. No. In between, we have something called the web views. And the web views is one component that looks, it has Kafka views on the states, and from there is that we get our data. So web views can see everything that is happening in the whole anti-span. So it's the one that knows essentially, that has all the information. And with that, that's how we communicate from the anti-span web UI to the web views. And in between, as you see in that line, we have a gRPC layer. Now, we have something called runway. And runway is the responsible of training my clustering algorithm. And why is the name runway? Well, because it hosts many machine learning models. And we know that Victoria's Secret models, they work on the runway. And here I'm specifying that this is Python because it's our only component in Python. The rest of them, it's done on Go. But since we have gRPC and Kafka, which is kind of a language agnostic, there's no problem to use them. So once again, we have the Antispam Web UI. From there, we click, we go to the web views. The web views is going to talk with Conviction and the other components. It's going to gather all the scores, and then it's going to store them in one database. Simple as that. So to quickly recap this part here, we have our mouse. We click on it, web views. We use the views to get data from Conviction. We send the data to Runway, and then we store the results in the database. But what's happening in WebViews? This is where most of the magic happens. So follow me and let's take a look. Fisher vector. So the Fisher vector is the set of confidence score that we want to cluster. For example, confidence one or confidence two. However, it is not as simple as just collecting them, building a database, building a data frame, sorry, and sending them to Runway, because there's one large issue here. And that's that not every user has the same confidence score. For example, let's suppose that I am a new user and I have never sent a message. So I don't have any confidence score regarding messaging. For example, user one has score C1, C2, C3. User two has C2, C3, C4. And user five has C5 and C6. But still, we need to cluster with all our score. So what we did here first is that using our views, we create a union set of all the confidence score. And then for each of these users, we're going to retrieve those confidence score. And if one user doesn't have any of them, then we use the default value, for example, 0. And then we cluster. And how do we cluster? Well, we use optics. And the optics algorithm is a very cool one. And it's called an ordering point to identify the clustering structure. And it is a density-based algorithm, meaning that it's going to find highly dense area and consider that the cluster. On the other hand, we have another very famous clustering algorithm, K-means, which is a partition-based algorithm. And in partition, you're going to essentially partition your large space into K parts. And here is a bit different. Here, we're not partitioning anything. We're just trying to find very highly dense areas. And optics, it has two main hyperparameters. One of them is called min points, or the minimum of points, and epsilon. Minimum of points is the minimum of data sets, the minimum of data points that you need to have in a certain area defined by epsilon to consider that a dense area. So if you have min points within epsilon, then that's dense, and then that might be one cluster. Otherwise, it's not. It could be noise. And controlling these two hyperparameters, it's quite good. It grants you a lot of flexibility. But on the other hand, it's very messy because you need to find an optimal set of them. And there's a lot of try and error here because sometimes you have like a large value, a small one, and so on. So they can get quite complicated. And here we have an example taken from scikit-learn. And on the left, we have what happened if you use the default values. So we have like a very nice output, I would say, where we have like a very large cluster and also small cluster, because optics is also good at finding cluster of different density. But what would happen if we decrease our epsilon to 0.5? Then we are missing one cluster. And in general, our clusters are smaller than the previous one because we are not further exploring our whole space. On the other hand, if we increase our epsilon to 2.0, then we have a larger cluster with less noise, but we lost one of them. So in our case, we're using as a default value min points of 20 that we can override from our API call. So the outcome, what's actually happened here? So let's go back to the first screen. I'm here, I click, and I'm going to cluster. So that's click number one. And this is my next screen. And here I can do several things. First, I have the option to fit a TSNA model so I can see the data in a low dimensionality. I can also apply min max to the data just to scale it to be on the same range. And then I can specify if I want to cluster all of my confidence or if I want to cluster just several sets, for example, image related confidence or light related confidence. And this is good because sometimes let's suppose that we're having like a spam wave related to images, and we want to rapidly have like a new rule based on images. Then in such a case, we're going to cluster only this tiny group. And the optimal thing here would actually be to have like a complete list of all the confidences, but so far it's becoming a bit difficult because we have them hard coded. So we need to find a way to get that data to our web UI so we're able to select which one. So after that, we click the blue button, apply, and I have one small confession. Right now, today, I actually need 3 clicks. What happened was that when I submitted the talk very early, we only needed 2 of them. But since now I've been adding more and more features, then I need 3 clicks. But it's still okay, right? It's only like another click. It shouldn't be an issue. So sorry about that. So now we cluster, and this is what we have. Well, the first of the screen. Here we have some basic information, such as the date, the status, because sometimes if the algorithm takes way too long, we're going to see the word running. Items cluster, how many users we cluster. And the features, which mean how many confidences score. And then on the right column, we have the use confidences. And once again, I'm hiding most of them because spammers, you know, they could be around and I don't want to tell them, hey, this is the information I'm looking at. But here we have one, this called reputation mail. And to keep it simple, let's say that this score tells you whether you are male or not. So we have that. And then, and this is my favorite view, here we have a small info box with all of our cluster, and including cluster minus one. And cluster minus one is actually a bit misleading because it's not a cluster. That's the noise. Those are the items that the algorithm wasn't able to cluster. And still, I really like cluster minus one because you can learn a lot about these users. Why is this user not a part of this cluster? Especially when you know that the user is quite close to them. And this gives you like a lot of room for thought and to think like, what do I have to do? What's going on here? And also it gives you like the idea or like the motivation to keep tweaking your hyperparameters to see if the next time you have less users here in minus one and more users in the other. But then we have cluster, let's say from 0 to 5. And I want to focus on cluster number 0 because it's resembled the example I mentioned earlier that we have here 25 users. And 23 of them are spammers. So 92% of my users here are spammers. So the easy thing would be here to click that button that says batch all 25 users. That's actually the third button to block them. So that's the button that blocks the user and it's my favorite one. So then after that info box, I have this information which I already showed. So let's just skip through that one. And I have like a nice table. And in this table, I see my user ID. I see the cluster where they belong and whether or not they are spammer. Pretty straightforward. And then, and this is also one of my favorite ones, I not keep saying this because all of them are my favorite one. Here we have the cluster descriptive statistics. And this table has all the features and all the clusters, and it shows you a lot of information about them. And this is cool. This is very, very useful because it gives you like a very good idea of what's going on in that cluster. For example, here I have my feature called photographer number of pictures, which is it counts how many images the user has uploaded. And here I'm looking at the one from cluster 1 and cluster 3. And I'm going to focus on the third column, mean. And we can see that the average number of images in cluster 1 is larger than those that we have in cluster 3. So there's obviously some separation here. There's something going on. Most of my users in cluster 1, they have a lot of images. And once again, this gives me like a lot of information and ideas that I could use to create my rules. And to even confirm my results, if you take a look at the standard deviation, in cluster 1 is 5.8, while in the other one is 0.56. And of course, if you look at the max value, then we know that we have one user with 36 images in that cluster. And in cluster 3, a user with only 2 images. So. And next we have something that is called the cluster analysis. And this one gives you like a brief overview of what's going on at each cluster and in the cluster itself. But first I'm gonna explain what they mean and then I'm going back to the table. So let's take a look here. So the first score that I'm looking is something called the silhouette coefficient. And silhouette is just a score that measures the cohesion and separation of a cluster. In other words, it measures how close you are to your pals, to your friends, and how far away you are from the others. And I like to use a very simple example. Suppose that we are in a high school cafeteria, and there are 3 tables. You have the tables with the popular people, the table with the sport people, and the table with the nerds. And since they are very tight together, everybody's on their table, then this cluster, this silhouette is going to be one, because everybody is where they should be. However, what happened if one day, one of the sport guy, he wants to talk with one of the nerds, like, hey, I need help for tomorrow's exam. So as soon as that person gets up and go to the other table, then we know that there's something going on. The whole cluster, the harmony is going to break because this user should be here, but now he's in the other table. So now the silhouette coefficient of that cluster is going to decrease. It's going to get closer to -1. And then we have another score. This one is called Davis Bolding. And Davis here, he measures the separation among clusters. So it's a score that measures the ratio between the intra-cluster distance, what is the distance between the members of my cluster, and the distance between all the other clusters. And this score, it goes from 0 to 1, where lower values indicate better clustering. So again, back to the table, now that we know what they actually mean. So the overall cluster, the overall silhouette score here is 0.77, which is good. It means that almost everybody is sitting in on the right table. And the Davis Bolding score is 0.4, let's say, which is also like it's closer to 0 than 1. So let's say that is good. And, if we take a look at cluster number 3, the silhouette is 90. So in that table, everybody is even more close together. On the other hand, cluster 2 is 0.60. So people are more like hanging around, let's say, like more separated here. So here, if I would have to make any decision of whether do I want to block someone, yes or no, then I'm going to be a little bit more certain that cluster 3 is the I don't want to say correct, but it's like the most correct one, let's say, you know, because all the scores are pointing that, hey, this is actually a good cluster. So if I combine this information with the percentage of spammer, and maybe if I look a little bit at the statistics, then that could give me like the whole idea I need, like the whole view of whether or not this cluster is good or bad. So now for the takeaways. Things that I like, and well, I like everything, but I like that the system works. In my opinion, it works. It allows us to get cases that otherwise we wouldn't catch with the system that we have as of today. And I really enjoy, I have no idea why, I enjoy so much to see the cluster spam percentage, because once again, it gives me like a lot of room for thought. And it brings up the questions like, why didn't we catch this user? Or what should we do to catch this user in the future? And it's also like a very good way to create labeled data sets, because after I cluster my users, I will soon, I'm gonna see, I have like one button which is called download file, and I can download my file well with all the feature vectors and the label of the cluster. And from this, you can also, I mean, you can go to Python and do whatever you want with the data set. And also I like the statistic and cluster analysis part, but that's more like the nerdy cluster part of me. Honestly, I believe I would be sitting in the nerd table. So what I don't like, well, optics can be a bit slow, and sometimes we have some issues with timeout and so on, and so we still need to do a lot of work on that. One solution would be to implement our own optics on the Go side, and that would solve so many issues. For example, we could avoid sending data from one side to the other, plus, of course, we could gain some speed. And what could be better? Well, how to interpret the cluster statistic and analysis. And I'm dedicating this slide to my colleagues because they are not so into cluster as I am. And when they use the tool, they need to call me and be like, Juan, what are the meaning of all these numbers? You know, who is Davis? And I would like something like a small summary, maybe like a small sentence saying that, in Juan's opinion, cluster A is better than cluster B. You know, like something very simple that they could use. Or, but I mean, to be honest, I cannot enjoy when they call me. So that's also quite a bad idea, I would say. And now for the future, this is very nice. So for the future, we want to fit a supervised learning model using one or more of the clusters as the positive class and the rest as the negative class. And the idea here is to form a decision tree and to automatically create new conviction rules from what the tree has learned. Let me show you how. Suppose that this is our data set. We have our features, reputation, mail, number of images, another score, and here we have the cluster. And we have cluster minus one, one, and two, and two. And then the label is span. But if you look at those from cluster two, and I say, well, 100% of the people in that cluster, they seem to be spammers. So what if I create a new data set or a new column where everything that is cluster two is my new positive label, and everything that is not is my negative label? And this seems like a very nice formatted data set to do supervised learning. So then I just fit the model, my decision tree, using the new data set. And going back to the main screen, something that I didn't show is that there's one button there. This is like click number four, but it's actually not. This is like an extra part, so it still counts as my three clicks are still good. And I click that, and then I have like another screen, of course. That's another click here. And here I choose what cluster I want to use as my positive label. So I choose, let's say, cluster number zero, and then I fit. And going back to the first slide where we have the architecture, now it's even simpler because we already have the data in Postgres. So it's just a matter of getting the data from there and through the web views, sending it to Rogue and fitting our model. And now comes the first problem. It doesn't work, really. The results are awful because, of course, if I'm training a model, such a model, you need to do a little bit of pre-processing. You know, you need to do like feature engineering. And right now I'm not doing anything. I'm just clicking because that's the point of my tool. And as we can see here, for this example, the average F1 score found during validation is very slow. It's very low, only 0.33, and the standard deviation too. So I'm not pleased with this result. And well, I want to be honest. I want to show also the good and the bad. So I don't like this, and it's awful. However, there's something very nice that we can take from here. And if we interpret the internal representation of my tree, and once again, I'm having to hide some things, we can see that in some way, this is, of course, a rule-based system. They're just like a bunch of if. So the goal here is that at some point, getting all this information under labels and finding somehow, I still do not know how, to send them to conviction and try to enforce or like to enrich our code and rule system with what the decision tree has learned. But that's a story for another day. Today, I'll just keep talking about cluster. Thank you for your time. It's been a lovely pleasure to present my lovely clusters today with all of you. You have more information. If you want more information, I believe I still have around 10 minutes for questions. And yes, also say no to spam. And I have a link to Goka. That's our open source package that we use to manage Kafka in Go. And a small paper we wrote like 2 years ago explaining some of our processes. And yeah, happy conference and thank you.
Very nice. Thank you very much for your talk. Yes, you. Everybody, feel free to send in questions via the question tab on the right side next to the chat. And while we are waiting for that, maybe one, do you have any, you said it works, do you have any measurements yet compared to what you did before? Is there any, the success rate, basically?
Cool. I can't give you like an exact number because at the moment, since we're still building the tool, I just click, I block people. And then, well, at the end of the day, so since we have a lot of way to know if, okay, the percentage of daily blocks and their source, of course, the one we still find with clusters is very small because it's actually not something automatic. I need to go to our web UI and do the whole thing. And compared to the thousands of systems that we have that are blocking users on a continuously basis, then it's just like a very small percentage. And still, I really like it because we are blocking people that we found that we otherwise wouldn't have caught. So that's actually very nice.
Okay, then there is a question.
Yes.
Is the UI that you show, is it internally developed or is it available somewhere?
No, so we are using, God. That's because it was like one of my colleagues who did it. So we're using Bootstrap. I don't remember the name of the theme right now. Maybe I'll just find it or just ask me later so I can have your name and then I'll send it to you. So we got like the template and yeah, of course we have modified a lot of things. For example, to add the tables, to add the plots. The plots I have is actually using Plotly. So they have to make some small changes to actually fit it. But, you know, to be honest, since it is our internal tool, we actually don't care about how pretty it is. Yeah. I just want to click, you know, click, 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 click. Yeah.
Yeah. You want your 2, 3, maybe 3.5 clicks, maybe.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, yeah.
Then there is another question. How do you know if someone is a spammer in the beginning? Is it based on people reporting spammers, or what is the technique behind that?
Well, God, I could be talking like years about this. You know, we started this like 5 years ago, so it's been like a constant thing of collecting data, of learning about it, of managing the right rule system. We also use, of course, like report from people. We also learn what spammers are, you know, for example, what can I say? You know, yeah, let's suppose that we have like a female user, you know, that 99% of her swipes are likes, you know, there's something wrong, because usually female, they don't act in that way. So you could tell like maybe this is a spammer that is just trying to get people. So it's a combination of using tools like this, you know, and domain knowledge, and also like, well, expertise, I would say, because it's been quite a while.
Okay. There is another question.
Yeah.
What is the frequency of clustering? Is it by time or quantity inputs? Can you add some words about the cost if possible?
So, all right. The frequency is just whenever we want to do it. Again, it's nothing. There's nothing automatic about it. I just try, like, if I see that we have like a batch of user that seems to be fishy or something, then I just do it. But again, like, we don't have any frequently. We don't have like any automatic training thing yet, because I wanted to have as a tool that we use it manually, because again, we have so many automatic things, and sometimes you cannot lose sight of the actual problem. And this is gonna sound very silly, I would say, but to keep learning about this, sometimes you need to get your hands dirty, and you need to go straight to the users, and you need to see the data so you can learn. Because if we keep doing automatic, then at some point, something is going to happen, you know, but I actually like to take a small break and see my users and try to learn more about them. As for the cost, well, I mean, we have this in Runway, and we use Google Cloud, and Runway is running on quite a large machine. You know, I believe it has over 32 gigs of RAM, because sometimes we use a lot of data, and also like we're using quite a very fast CPU, because I don't want this to take like 2 hours for cluster like some users. So I can't give you like an exact number, because I don't handle billing, you know. I just click again. it's not a cheap matching. It's not something that I would do here on my own Google Cloud just for fun. No.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then maybe a final question before we head over to the breakout. Are there any other streams or use cases you can imagine where this would be useful?
Oh, cool. Well, I focus a lot on spammers, but I'm starting to use it for fraud also, because it's nice to see the behavior of users and how they react on the online streams, you know, like the way they actually, they handle their credits, because, how do I say this? Because like, well, the way we've been finding fraud, since it's just like a new topic, I actually learned the company the second time for that, so we're still getting our feet wet. It's just by looking at how they use their money, let's say their internal money, like the credits, as we call it. So we are trying to apply it for this, just to have some small clusters, like, okay, here I have users that get money in a very quick way, but spend it in a slow way, or we have users that get credits in a very rapid way, and they spend it on the same day. So we're kind of still trying to learn more about it. So I would say that, yes, we're using it for trying to find fraud.
Okay. And just another question arrived. Yeah. So, how do you deal with the 2 users that you blocked from the cluster when the 23 users were spammers? Can you roll back blocking?
Your
customer service realizes, oh, there is something mislabeled or wrong.
Yeah. Yeah. So when I click that button, the button said something like batch users. Oh, I don't have it here. So let me go back quickly to see if I have. Okay, I can. Yeah. So when I click that button, so yes, we close, we punish our user, but at the same time, we create one batch of user, and these batches, they have IDs, and we store them somewhere. So I can just go to our list of batches. I go back and I see my users. And of course, the same way as I block them, I have like another button that we use for another thing to unpunish everybody who belongs to that batch of user. So yes, and we have done it a few times.
Okay.